Okay, we're back. This is Dave Vellante of Wikibon. I'm here with Jeff Kelly, my co-host. We're going to wrap up the day today, the MongoDB Days, live from New York City. We're here at the Marriott Marquis. We've been going all day, wall-to-wall coverage of this event. Jeff Kelly, we learned a lot today. In particular, you know, we've obviously been following Mongo and TenGen and noticed the uptake in the marketplace. What we heard today is really the polymorphic nature of Mongo is what was so appealing to people, the ability to ingest different types of data and the variety of data, as people often talk about, one of the V's. That was one of the big attractions early on. The second is obviously the simplicity that goes along with Mongo. People consistently kept saying, yes, it just made my life so much easier, packaging in the auto-scaling capabilities and the like. So what are your takeaways from today?
Well, I think confirmed. A lot of the enthusiasm we've been seeing that we've seen in various communities that we've been tracking, seeing it here in person. Clearly, there's a lot of passion among the user base, in the TenGen user base, and Mongo developers. Clearly, they love Mongo to allow them to build these applications. You said polymorphic in nature. It could be any type of data, but allows them to work with that data in a very simple and easy way to build applications that really have a simple, elegant feel to them. So clearly there's a lot of enthusiasm around the database itself. From the perspective of TenGen as a company, clearly I was very impressed with Max Yersin, first time I met him in person. Very sharp guy. I think they're in good hands there. They're growing like crazy. They're over 250 people. I believe he said that, they're shooting for 500 in the next year or two. And the really interesting thing is they've got over 100 of their current 250 employees or engineers working on the product. So this is clearly, they are still focused on the hardcore technology. A couple of things. They're looking, obviously, to continue to build out some of the functionality, but really to add those capabilities to make it really enterprise-ready, enterprise-hardened. And they're starting to do that, and they're starting to gain traction. We saw some of the speakers here today were companies like MetLife and Goldman Sachs, Citigroup. TenGen has created a financial services advisory board where they're bringing in folks from companies like I just mentioned to talk about the different ways Mongo and NoSQL technology could be applied in financial services. So clearly they have their sights on the enterprise and specifically financial services. So for them to be able to do that, clearly it's about adding even more of those capabilities around monitoring and managing your Mongo instance. We had Matt Acey on today, and he mentioned, quite frankly, those are a couple areas we need to do better on, and they're working on that. So I think they've got the right priorities. Clearly they're in a very good position, riding a lot of momentum of the database itself, which is just very popular. Got a great passionate community around it. So they're in very good shape. We heard some really interesting use cases today around, some larger companies like ADP building mobile applications and using analytics really to inform some of the way they serve up data through those applications. We talked with Charity from Parse today, who was very enthusiastic about what her company's doing, kind of building the back end using Mongo to serve up, to basically really make a simple and a durable infrastructure and platform so that developers can build their mobile apps on top of that. So from partners to kind of the end users and the folks inside TenGen, very impressed today.
Yeah, so we obviously talk a lot about big data, and David Floyer actually had a big data forecast that he published earlier this year on Wikibon. A lot of action in database. We've talked about this a lot. Certainly John Furrier has mentioned this a number of times. Database used to be kind of the boring market, and now it's the smoking hot market. And big data and Hadoop is part of that reason. Looking at those forecasts now, you're talking about a $5 billion market by 2017, with the NoSQL portion of that growing about twice as fast as the SQL portion. Interestingly enough, within big data, SQL's not dying. People are adding SQL capabilities to big data. You're seeing companies bring sort of SQL to NoSQL. So it's given it being a SQL a lift, but nonetheless, NoSQL's growing substantially faster, even though the SQL piece will continue to be the largest piece of the big data market.
Well, SQL's going to continue to grow because I think what we're seeing in this case, we're seeing Mongo on kind of the transactional side of the equation, supporting online applications that have to serve up data in real time. to discrete users. Where SQL is going to definitely continue to grow, however, in the big data sense, is to support analytic workloads. So you're seeing databases like GreenPlum and Vertica are going to continue to see significant adoption because they just play a really key role in doing that high speed, very fast data ingest and real time ad hoc query capabilities that you don't get right now in something like Hadoop. So that's where I think a lot of the growth related to SQL and big data is concerned. But NoSQL is going to go right alongside it. NoSQL databases are adding capabilities every day to kind of get to that point where they are really truly enterprise hardened. It's still a journey and we're getting there, but I mean clearly from some of the attendees here and speakers of this conference, MongoDB for instance is in full production use in large enterprises, so there's no question it's enterprise ready for certain use cases. So that's going to continue, and as that happens, as that evolution continues, you're going to just see an uptick in the use of and adoption of NoSQL technology. And then of course at some point, and we've talked about this over the last 6 months or so, Dave, at some point the capabilities are merging a little bit. SQL databases are taking on some of the characteristics of NoSQL, being able to work with some less than fully structured data. And NoSQL databases are starting to add more of the relational style capabilities as well as some of the more enterprise-y capabilities or qualities. And at some point, the conversation is that a NoSQL database, is it a SQL database, is going to become less important. And it's going to be more a question of what's your use case, what's the value proposition of the different databases that can potentially serve that use case, and making the best choice. And it's not going to be a matter of should we use SQL or NoSQL, it's going to be what's the best database.
Yeah, so now you're the first person to really size the big data market space. And when you look at the pure plays, like a 10Gen, or a Cloudera, or Hortonworks, or pick your pure play du jour, the actual size of the market is quite small today. I mean, we're talking about maybe it's hundreds of millions, mm-hmm. it's relatively small, but it's growing very, very quickly. But the market's still looking for that, real IPO ready, big data pure play. Splunk, maybe, Tableau, kinda.
I wouldn't put Tableau in that
category.
Right,
because those guys were sort of predated, Hadoop, big data. Splunk, maybe not, but nonetheless, when you think about the database market in particular and the analytics business, the infrastructure business, no one has emerged. Clearly 10Gen has an opportunity to be that. However, my analysis on this says they've got to expand their TAM, and the way in which they're doing that is into the enterprise. So that's why you're hearing so much emphasis on making Mongo more enterprise ready, things like backup, things like monitoring, adding the services on top of that, training for free, which I think is brilliant. I think it's a brilliant model. But what's your take on the opportunity and challenges for 10Gen? What would your advice be to them?
Sure. So I think the challenge is, some of it is just kind of perception. It's still a relatively young technology. It's a startup, in New York City, growing like crazy. But still, it's when you compare it to something like an IBM, and obviously there's a big perception in terms of the enterprise readiness of the product. But I agree completely with your analysis that the enterprise is where they need to go. That's where they're really going to start building revenue. What I would recommend is to continue doing partnerships like they've recently announced with IBM, where that partnership is all about allowing, making it easier to unlock all that data that's locked in DB2 and other databases, and making it easy for developers to build applications on Mongo like they always have, but able to serve up data in these currently kind of off limits or dark corners of the enterprise, where all this really valuable data lives, mainly structured, but it's got years of historical data, extremely valuable but difficult up until recently, and at least in the IBM DB2 example, for a Mongo developer to unlock it. So I think one of the keys is making Mongo more integrated and interoperable with kind of legacy data stores, being able to bring in data from wherever it may live. So I would recommend do more partnerships like that with IBM. Make it easier to bring Mongo into an enterprise environment and extract value from data wherever it lives in the enterprise. When you start doing that, then you really unlock some of the possibilities of the new new types of applications you can build. We talked today about taking that, your systems of record data and kind of the interaction data and merging those together and delivering a mobile application that you just can't do otherwise without both of those parts of the equation. So I would recommend doing that. I think it's also important to continue the education. Part of this is it's a natural evolution. I guess maybe the analogy I might use is the R programming language is very popular kind of in the academic community, and as students kind of leave the university and they go into the enterprise, they're bringing R with them, so that's putting pressure on SAS, for instance. So I think something similar is going to happen with Mongo, as we've got a lot of these young developers that love Mongo, it's very popular, they're building applications, and as they start to grow up a little bit, literally, then they're going to start popping up in more positions of influence inside large enterprises, and that's going to help bring Mongo along. So I think it's a little bit of both of those things, but they're very well positioned to do that. And clearly, I think they have their eye on the ball. I think, again, Max Schierson, impressive guy. I think he clearly understands, and if you look at their announcements, they're focused on not just the enterprise, but specifically financial services. They've got some big names speaking here, which I was frankly surprised to see people like Goldman Sachs and MetLife at this conference. So to me, that shows that they've got some traction, and I would encourage them to keep doing that.
There were some serious practitioners here. Let's talk a little bit more about the IBM announcement, the partnership, the whole DB2 thing. Basically, what we heard today from a number of our guests was the comparison to Linux. When IBM made the move into Linux, it precipitated the adoption of that standard. Others obviously joined in. Oracle, endorsing Linux obviously helped as well. But IBM's role in open source is pretty substantial. And so, break down for us, in your view, what IBM is trying to do with the announcement that it's going to basically incorporate the Mongo standard into the DB2 such that DB2 programmers can access these capabilities natively.
Well, I think very simply, IBM understands that MongoDB is a very popular database. They see the success developers are having building applications with it, and they need to enable their customer base to kind of enter the 21st century and start building the mobile and web applications that their customers demand. IBM could have developed some of this technology internally, but I think they made the strategic decision that it was a better play to partner with MongoDB, bring them into, make it compatible with DB2 and really empower their legacy customers that way. I think where this leads in the future in terms of the relationship with IBM, it's hard to say, but I think clearly IBM understood that to really follow through on their mobile first initiative or promise, if you will, they needed to invest in or partner with some technology providers that allow them to really do that and make it easy for their customers to actually build these kind of mobile applications that take advantage of structured, unstructured data. And the kind of applications, frankly, that we're becoming used to using in the consumer world, and are increasingly in demand in the enterprise. So that's my take on where IBM stands on this. I would recommend to Tengen to continue building partnerships out like this. I think that's really one way to start getting deeper into the enterprise. And it's one of those things where Mongo is so popular and so well-liked by the people that use it. The more people that use it, the better. So I would say leverage those partnerships to get into more users' hands.
Do you think that Tengen's an acquisition candidate for IBM, or do they not have to take that step?
I don't think they have to take that step now. I think that's probably a little...
Well, not now, but the way IBM often does acquisitions is they'll let a relationship bake. They'll get to know people. Are they a good fit? That's how IBM does it. I mean, sometimes they'll go out and grab a company, but IBM likes to
kind of
dance a little bit
yeah.
with its partners and get a feel for what that's going to look like. And is it a good strategic fit in your view?
It's a good question and a hard one to answer. I wish I had a crystal ball. I don't know the answer, but I think it's fair to say that IBM wouldn't make this partnership if that wasn't at least a possibility.
IBM is one of the best companies on the planet in terms of acquiring. I would say IBM, Oracle, and EMC, maybe Cisco, put Cisco in there. Perhaps the three best, as there's others. Intel's pretty good, Microsoft. Obviously, then you start to get into Google. But in the enterprise, it's really IBM, Oracle, and EMC are, the, to me, the three big companies that are really, really good at acquiring. Well, and a cut above everybody else.
Yeah, I mean, the reason I would say Tengen is certainly a candidate for acquisition by IBM is that IBM, this was one of their big holes, as I wrote in my research note when this partnership was announced. We've often said IBM really has the widest and deepest portfolio of big data related products and services, but one hole, I think, was on this NoSQL front. And specifically around database technology to help support mobile applications bringing in all sorts of data types. So they've filled that hole in a sense with this partnership. So clearly if they don't have the technology, they're either going to develop internally or acquire. So it's a possibility. I don't think it's imminent, certainly.
We were talking to a practitioner in the Wikibon community the other day, and I agree with what he said. He said basically IBM's got all these pieces. They got the portfolio, but they still have to put the story together in a more compelling way that conveys the business value to the IBM customer. That's something that IBM is usually really good at. Last year you were at IOD, we started to really hear those business values messages. A year before that, it was just sort of run amok. So I would expect that this October or November, whenever IOD is, we're really going to start to hear that crisp messaging, but that would be an expectation. And they're excited about the Tengen partnership and Mongo. And IBM, as I've said a number of times, is big on open source, they're going all in.
Yeah, I mean, this is clearly, when IBM puts their kind of stamp of approval on a technology like this, that's clearly a good thing for Mongo and Tengen. So, in terms of IBM getting their messaging together, I think they've been doing a much better job recently. I mean, you're right, a couple of years ago, if you looked at one of their PowerPoint slides about here's our big data portfolio, I mean, your eyes would cross. There were so many products and arrows, and it was very difficult to follow. So right, so their challenge has been to kind of package those into services and solutions really that tackle business problems and translate all that technology into how it provides business value. That's still a little bit of a challenge for IBM. It's a work in progress, but they're getting better at that. And again, I would agree with you. I would expect a much cleaner message at IOD this year.
All right, Jeff. Well, listen, it's been a real pleasure working with you. I thought you did a great job today. It's been a fun week. Crushed it at the GE event. You really did a great job there conveying the whole industrial internet, sizing that piece up. We did the O'Reilly Velocity Conference. A lot of similarities between what we heard at Velocity and what we're hearing from the developers within the Mongo community. Props to Tengen for really shepherding that community and providing governance and momentum behind it. It's very clear, it's palatable at this event, and there are several of these events. So, really appreciate Tengen having us here. Go to siliconangle.com, check out all the blogs associated with the videos today, check out all the news. Go to youtube.com/siliconangle, and you'll see playlists from all the events that we do throughout the year. And also go to wikibon.org, check out all the free research that we have there. We're live on SiliconANGLE TV, we've updated that site, so check that out as well. Really appreciate everybody watching, appreciate the tweets and the questions. Thanks Andrew, Alex, and Mick, great job, and to the team in Dallas, and Kristen Nicole's team, all the great write-ups that you guys do, really appreciate it. And also Jeff Frick and John Furrier, thanks for all the tweets today. All right, well this is a wrap everybody, thanks for watching. This is theCUBE, we really appreciate your attention and assistance and support. And we'll see you next time. We'll be at Hadoop Summit next week, next Wednesday and Thursday, live from the San Jose Convention Center. Look for theCUBE, watch us. Thanks everybody, we'll see you next time.